Good morning. Please stand and join in singing number 724.
Welcome, everyone. We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Well, welcome, everyone. As I was standing outside greeting people, I could start to feel the rain come. So, with any luck, we'll have a nice little rain shower today. Might moisten the earth and give us a little more of a moisture for our plants and our yards. And of course, this is a special day. We celebrate Father's Day today, so happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there. And this Mass is also being offered in loving memory of Gladys Fettig. So we pray for Gladys and for her repose and her family, as well as for all the fathers of our life, the spiritual fathers, the biological fathers, the adopted fathers. And we thank God for the blessings we have had in our life. And so as we come together, as we prepare to celebrate this Eucharist, let us take a moment to call to mind our own lives and trust in God's mercy. Lord Jesus, you came to free us from evil. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you bring comfort to those who are burdened. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you love us with a divine love. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
We pray to, we bless.
Let us pray. O God, strength of those who hope in you, graciously hear our pleas. And since without you mortal frailty can do nothing, grant us always the help of your grace, that in following your commands, we may serve you by our resolve and our deeds. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. In those days, the Israelites came to the desert of Sinai and pitched camp. While Israel was encamped here in front of the mountain, Moses went up the mountain to God. Then the Lord called to him and said, "Thus shall you say to the house of Jacob, tell the Israelites, you have seen for yourselves how I treated the Egyptians, and how I bore you up on eagle's wings, and I brought you here to myself. Therefore, if you hearken to my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my special possession, dearer to me than all other people. Through all the earth is mine, you shall be to me a kingdom of priests, a holy nation." The word of the Lord. From the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, Christ, while we were still helpless, yet died at the appointed time for the ungodly. Indeed, only with difficulty does one die for a just person, though perhaps for a good reason, one might even find courage to die. But God proves his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. How much more then, since we are now justified by his blood, will we be saved through him from the wrath? Indeed, if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, how much more, once reconciled, will we be saved by his life? Not only that, but we also boast of God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now have received reconciliation. The word of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. At the sight of the crowds, Jesus' heart was moved with pity for them, because they were troubled and abandoned, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is abundant, but the laborers are few. So ask the master of the harvest to send out laborers for his harvest." Then he summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to drive them out and to cure every disease and every illness. The names of the 12 apostles are these: first, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew, James the son of Zebedee and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon from Cana, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. Jesus sent out these 12 after instructing them thus: "Do not go into pagan territory or enter a Samaritan town. Go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, make this proclamation: the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, drive out demons. Without cost you have received, without cost you are to give." The Gospel of the Lord. For the past few weeks, I've been watching a particular show on Netflix. The show is called Beef, and it's kind of a comedy slash drama, and it stars two main characters. There's a male and female main character. And the show starts out with them each in their cars, and they're in a parking lot, and they almost get into a little bit of an accident. But that near fender bender causes each of the characters to get enraged at one another, and they begin to honk at one another and throw things at one another. And then that little encounter leads them on a car chase down the interstate where they're trying to run each other off the road. And then it kind of finally ends, and both of them are fine. They don't get into an accident. But they leave that incident, and neither one of the main characters can let go of that incident. They become obsessed with the other person, you know, looking up who they are and where they live and what they do, and they begin to carry out acts of vengeance upon one another. You know, they start to, you know, do little pranks that are kind of small at first, but they keep getting more and more, extreme as the show continues, and it begins to escalate to really kind of, you know, dangerous levels. Now, I won't spoil the ending. It's a very good show, although it's a little adult, so you might want to let the kids go to bed first. But there's a powerful scene towards the end of the series, and it features the female main character. And she's in her therapist's office, and she's talking about her anger. And her therapist asks her, you know, "Where do you think this anger comes from?" And she begins to reflect, and she recalls a moment when she was a little girl. And she was awoken one night, and she could hear her parents fighting. And she could hear her parents saying, "We don't have enough money. We should have never had a child. You know, what were we thinking? We never should have had a daughter." And that memory, that incident, hearing her parents say that, creates a deep wound in her heart. It's this wound that she carries with her for the rest of her life. And she begins to question whether it's possible to be loved unconditionally. And she even begins to question her own ability to love others unconditionally. And this memory, this feeling of not being worthy of love, of not being loved by her parents, leads her to try to earn her love in her life by doing well in school, by being successful in business, by being always happy and pleasing. and she feels like she has to put on this facade for people so that they will see that she's good and that they will love her. And she discovers that it's this trying to prove herself, trying to earn her love, is what causes this anger to build up within her. It's what causes that anger to kind of be bottled up until it's finally unleashed on this stranger in a fender bender accident. Now, when I saw this scene, you know, I was really kind of taken aback by it. For I thought, you know, in my life, have I been loved unconditionally? You know, I think that's something that a lot of us might wonder. And what does unconditional love look like? You know, I certainly can look to my own parents. You know, today's Father's Day, and my father was a very, you know, good father. My father was kind of intimidating, though, to a lot of my friends, and they never wanted to sleep over because my dad would get really kind of, he could throw kind of a fit if he's like, this coffee's not warm enough, you know, this is stupid, and he would kind of be outwardly kind of angry. But one thing that I remember about my father is that while he might have gotten angry or upset or impatient over little things, when it came to the big things, he was always patient and kind. You know, when it came to me really getting into trouble at school or having a friend be sick, my father was so patient and loving. In fact, whenever I was sick, my dad always, you know, waited on me, you know, hand and foot, and almost to the point where I'm like, Dad, just leave me alone. I just want to sleep. But he was always knocking on my door asking if I wanted tea or if I wanted a cup of soup. And I think we learn love from our parents, from our families. But love is one of those things that connects us all as human beings. You know, every person needs love. Every person desires love. You know, even from when we're born as little babies, if we're not shown love, if we're not held, that baby won't thrive. That baby won't mature in a healthy way. We need love. And as we get older, our desire, our need for love doesn't go away. If anything, it might grow stronger. It might grow deeper. And so we're asked, you know, how do we know love? How do we find love in our life? Where does the love come from? And I love, there's a quote from one of my favorite saints, Saint Catherine of Siena, the great Dominican. And she said, love comes from seeing oneself loved. That love comes from seeing us loved by someone else. And I think that's the key, to see that if we're to love others, we must first see how we are loved. Now, in this life, there's a lot of people that might love us, and that love might be better or worse depending on the relationship. But there's one place where I think we can find love, and that is from our God. You know, each of our readings this weekend speaks of love in different ways. In the first reading, we have the book of Exodus, and we have the scene when Moses has freed the people of Israel, and they've gone up to the mountain, and Moses goes to talk with God. And what does God say? But you are dearer to me than anyone else. You are dear to me. And that's why I carried you out of Egypt on eagle's wings. God is saying to Moses, I love you. I love the people. I am here for you. In the second reading, we have St. Paul, and he speaks of love in perhaps a different way. And he's speaking of Jesus and the sacrifice on the cross of Jesus. And he says, you know, how hard is it for someone to sacrifice their life for someone else, even if that person was good, even if that person was a saint? How hard that is even. But imagine how much more difficult it is to sacrifice yourself for someone else when they're not perfect, when they're not a saint, when they have their own sins, their own baggage, their own history. And yet that is what God did for us. Jesus, when he sacrificed himself for us, didn't do it because we had pleased God, didn't do it because we had earned God's love. He did it simply because he loved us. No matter where we were, no matter what we had done, Jesus loved us, even in the depths of our heart. And finally, we have this scene from the gospel when Jesus has just, you know, spoken to the crowds, and he sees this great multitude of people before him. And he sees not just their presence, but he sees also their troubles. He sees what worries them. He sees what burdens them. He sees the fear and the pain and the wounds that they carry with him. And it says that he is moved with pity. Now, I think a better translation would be, Jesus is moved with compassion. He's moved with compassion. And compassion is not simply love, it is love, but compassion is wanting to share in your struggles. Being moved by compassion is a desire to be there for you, to help you in your difficulties, to be standing with you in your pain. And so Jesus looks out and sees that crowd moved with compassion, and he wants them to know that they are loved. He wants them to know that they don't have to earn his love. He wants them to know that God is with them in their pain and their struggles. And so what does he do? He calls his 12 disciples, you know, the key inner circle, and he blesses them, and he says, now go out to the people and to bring mercy to them, to bring healing, to bring freedom to them. He's telling them basically to share with the people of Israel, the lost children, that God loves them, that they are dear to him, and to bring that message of God's love, to let them know that they are not alone, to let them know that compassion of God. Now, this is the message, this is the mission of Jesus, and it started over 2,000 years ago, but it continues today. You know, one thing I've always loved about the Mass is actually the blessing of the gifts. You know, it's kind of a small part of the Mass, but, you know, and usually we're thinking of the bread and the wine that are blessed. But in our understanding of the Mass and the Eucharist, what we're meant to do is to come to church and to bring our own burdens, to bring our own fears, to bring our own hopes and dreams, to bring everything that might be on our minds and our hearts, and to bring them with us to Mass. And then as we sit together, as we pray for the Holy Spirit to come down upon the gifts of the Mass, those things are included. We're asking the Holy Spirit to come upon us, to bless our lives, so that we might know that love of God, so that we might offer up our lives and share with God what we are struggling with, and that God's love might then rest upon us. And then as the Mass continues, we eventually receive Jesus in the Eucharist, and we're again receiving a pledge of God's love for us. You know, the Mass used to be called the Love Feast because it was celebrating the love of God for us. And then what happens after we receive the Eucharist and the Mass is over? We might go downstairs for some coffee and treats, but we're then sent out to the world, to our homes, to our workplace, and we're called to carry that love of God with us. We're called to carry that compassion of God with us and to bring that love of God to everyone that we encounter, to be able to stand with them, to be moved with compassion for them, to love them and to serve them, so that they can also know that love of God, that love of God that comes to us unconditionally, that love of God that is there at every moment of our lives, and that love of God that is calling us to recognize it and to share that love with others. We love because God first loved us. God loved us first when we were created. He loved us in our families. He loves us as we grow older. And finally, God loves us to the very end. And so as we celebrate this love of God, God is asking us just to do one thing, to love in return, to try our best to love God and to love those around us. And by doing so, we fulfill that mission, that covenant, that promise of God, that God will be with us, walking beside us, loving us to the end. And so let us now stand and bring our prayers and let us profess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Now let us bring our prayers and our needs to God. May God bless and inspire all the world's fathers with love, kindness, patience, and the strength to overcome obstacles. We pray to the Lord. Grant success and good weather to all farmers whose labor feeds and sustains us. We pray to the Lord. Drive out the evils of racism, sexism, homophobia, and all other systems of oppression. We pray to the Lord. Empower each of us gathered today to claim our call to discipleship. We pray to the Lord. We hold before God all who have asked for our prayers, including Bob Haller, Mary Gustafson, Jean Miller, Noreen Bowman, Rita Bach, Barbara Fettig, Peter Hamburg, Jackie Getch, Luke Morin, Susan Ward, Mike Purvis, Connie Cole, and Christopher and Jeanette Blazewich, along with Richard Mandery, and all those whose names we pray in private. We pray to the Lord. We pray for all who have died in the peace of Christ, including Eunice Aiken, Mark Rosenwinkel's aunt, Verdee Henry, Ken Heim, Judy Linholt, David Graff, and Jim Ronhorst, along with Gladys Fettig, for whom this Mass is offered. We pray to the Lord. And for all the prayers that we carry in the silence of our hearts. And for one another, we pray to the Lord. Gracious and loving God, help us to know your love for us this day, and hear these prayers that we have spoken and those in the silence of our hearts, for we ask them through Christ our brother. Amen.
Number 790.
Thank you.
Pray, friends, that my sacrifice and yours might be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and good of all his holy church. O God, who in the offerings presented here provide for the twofold needs of human nature, nourishing us with food and renewing us with your sacrament, grant, we pray, that the sustenance they provide may not fail us in body or in spirit, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you."
My Lord, my God.
In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Therefore,
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the gifts of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Bernard our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassionate, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Gathered together as God's family, we pray in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. And let us offer to one another a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Number 691.
Command to guide you in all of your ways.
Let us pray. As this reception of your Holy Communion, O Lord, foreshadows the union of the faithful in you, so may it bring about unity in your church through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I couldn't tell, did it start raining yet or is that still to come? I jinxed it, yes, I'm sorry, no. It's getting really hot today, you know. Well, I hope, if you're coming here for the first time or a returning visitor, I welcome you. And downstairs, of course, we will have coffee and various treats available. So I hope you can join us for a little bit of a post-mass reception. And also, starting this week, we're going to begin renovation on the kitchen floor downstairs. So for the remainder of June and into July, the kitchen will not be accessible because we're replacing the floors, but we'll still have Sunday treats available and various things. So, so sorry if we inconvenience you, but hopefully the work will be done soon and you can expect more updates about that coming. And finally, as I mentioned, today is Father's Day. So I thought it'd be appropriate to give a special blessing to fathers. So I invite you all to join me by raising your hands as we bless the fathers that are here, as well as pray for the fathers that are not with us today. God our Father, in your wisdom and love you made all things. Bless the men who have been our fathers, whether spiritual, biological, or adopted. Bless the men of our life who have taught us love, strength, patience, and compassion. Grant that we, their sons and daughters, may honor them always with a spirit of profound respect. Grant this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And thank you to all who have come, and maybe even some of our future fathers. I see little Lucas was very engaged in Mass, so maybe he'll be a spiritual father. You never know. So, but thank you all for joining us, and I hope you have a wonderful holiday weekend and a wonderful rest of your day. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Mass is ended. Let us go forth in the joy of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please join in singing number 546.
Baptizing us.
Thank you.